Hello everyone and welcome to Silent Hunter 4. Now, I decided to go with this game for the next let's play after watching the comments on my update video. And well, I will do a campaign with Silent Hunter 4, and if the following is good enough, I will probably do another one, this time with German submarines, maybe? Because there are mods for German submarines in this game to make them do the Atlantic campaign, so probably will do that. Of course, if everything goes to plan and people really like this series. At any rate, we are in July the 2nd, 1943, and we are in Perth, Fremantle, Australia. We are the commanders of USS Sailfish, SS-192, and we are going to be doing stuff in the Southeast Indies. Let's deploy to our little office here and take a look at our sub, which currently has a couple of 20mm anti-aircraft guns, a 3-inch deck gun, which after doing a couple of familiarization, because obviously I needed to play this game a little bit before doing a let's play, it's been a long time since I played this seriously. But with the mods I'm using, which are Real Fleet Boat and Run Silent, Run Deep, using the deck gun is suicidal. Because even mercants have deck guns, and if you are hit by a deck gun of a mercant, chances are you're going to get a blown up compartment, you're going to go down. So I'm not going to be using this a lot. We have a surface edge radar, which is really great. An air search radar, which is even better. We don't have an active sonar, which is kind of underwhelming, but what are we going to do? This, I guess, will become soon available. Torpedoes, we are carrying the infamous Mark 14, which I'm hoping by this stage of the war is working at least to a decent degree. And we have 4 bow and 4 aft torpedo tubes. The aft ones have 1 reload, the fore ones have 2 reloads. So, and we have 4 extended torpedo reserves in case we want to reload the reserves, which is kind of okay, I guess. As for crew, well, we don't have any reno, we can't get any new ones, so this is what we have. We have a couple of weapons officers here. I'm going to put them on the main deck, just in case we use the deck gun, which I just say that we are going to not to do, but well, just in case, you know. Yeah, this is our crew, and I think we are set. Realism options, I don't know where they are set, but they are all put on full. Hold on a second, back. Let me check if we can... There, gameplay settings. Well, it's not everything on full, but it's in... You're going to see... realistic. It's just realistic. External view I'm getting, obviously, because... we are going to look. And not map contact updates, well, the mods change the contact updates so they are more or less believable, so yeah, we'll leave that unchecked. That's our... is that fine, right? External view, yeah. I want no event camera, but I want the external view back. Okay, let's see where we are going to go. Seems near Singapore. 150 nautical miles east of the Singapore area. And do a 150 patrol area here. 4 days, we have to remain on station. Okay. So those are our orders. We are going to start out of the harbor because I don't want big load times here. And let's get going. Now, this is going to be quite interesting because most of the people who think about submarines, obviously, in World War II, obviously think of the German U-boats, and the American ones were quite different animals, well, being similar in concept, obviously. I mean, a submarine is a submarine, it's a ship that goes on the surface and can dive underwater for limited periods of time, right? But the American subs have some marked differences between themselves and the Germans. Now, if this loading screen throws us into the action, I'm going to be able to start commenting about them. Come on, come on. No, no, no. Destination Tokyo, no. Destination Singapore. I'm guessing here. Well, this is taking its merry time.
Yes, sir.
But we finally are in our beautiful submarine. Now this is the main operation zone. We have our charts here. We have our dials here. This dude is looking at some pretty lights. Those are the vents, actually. They are red because they are all closed. Then when they are green, they are open. I think it's how it works. This is the dive plane operator. And yeah, lots of goiches, lots of things. We are not going to even bother explaining what they do. Let's go to the deck. And here we are in a pretty beautiful summer day.
Yes, sir.
And we are going to start moving on ahead standard. Now, the first big difference between German U-boats and American ones were that the American ones were much, much bigger. German U-boat, the Type 7 was 700 tons of displacement. These things were 1,500. So yeah, it's they are much bigger. They are larger, obviously. That comes with some advantages. That comes with some disadvantages. The main advantage was that being so big, they had very good ranges. And as at standard speed, which I just ordered, you're going to see that when I ask for a maximum range at current speed, well, no, because it seems I'm charging batteries, I guess. Not sure, but the range is massive. The standard speed, which obviously we are accelerating, yeah, that's the main. Let's give it a little time. 16 knots. Okay, so now we go here and say, hey, how far can you reach? 1/4. Okay, it seems that this mod changes the the consumption. Hold on a second. Now we are talking. 6,511 miles on roughly 14-15 knots on the surface. That's immense for a submarine. Obviously, these things needed to be fleet boats. We needed to operate in the Pacific. And the range was really great. Compared with the U-boats, which had problems, the Type 7 couldn't operate on the East America coast unless they were supported by resupplying submarines. So yeah, there's that. Another big difference is that they usually mounted much bigger their guns. In this case, not, because we are mounting a 3 inch deck gun, but they could mount up to 5 inch deck guns. Another big difference is obviously being larger, they were much roomier. They were well, we all have the images of the U-boats in dashboard, with all the crew inside, with everything crowded with people and food stores and whatever. These things were much roomier. They had air conditioners, they had even a freezer, I think. The accommodation was much better, so long patrols weren't as bad in these things as in German subs. So far, it seems all is a really nice bag of very good features compared with the German submarines. They also have very advanced torpedo computers. The German ones have some advantages in some situations. The American ones are better in some other situations. I tend to like the American one a little bit more, but yeah, the Germans also have very good torpedo data computers. But the biggest difference is that these things were diesel electric, fully diesel electric. They had 4 diesel engines, which weren't hardwired into the electric engines. What happened here is that the diesel engines were producing power. That power was passed to the electric engines, and the electric engines would run the shafts all day long. Meanwhile, well, this were allowed was to put whatever combination of engines you wanted to charge. Meanwhile, the remaining engines would drive all the electric engines to drive the propellers. You could switch any combination of engines to drive the propellers and to charge the batteries, or to just put all of them online to achieve impressive speeds of up to 21 knots. Sorry. They also were quite fast underwater, 8.5 knots, something like that. The German U-boats were 7.5, something like that. The German ones, however, they had a hard wire, sort of a hard wire thing. The shafts were hard wire, they were physically connected to the engines, which means if you lost a diesel or an electrical engine, that shaft, you wouldn't be able to operate. This didn't. If you lost an electrical engine, the other one could drive both shafts. If you lost one diesel, you wouldn't care because they were driving the electrical engines, not the propellers, right? So it was much more flexible and survivable. There are some good instances of German U-boats with disabled engines that had to be abandoned because they couldn't sail. Meanwhile, it's very rare that to an American sub that will happen. So again, seems everything is good, right? Well, no, not really. There are some things that aren't as great. Being much larger, these things have a lot more of reserve flotation, which means they take longer to go under. So usually diving times in American boats were larger than in German cases. Being bigger also, that means there was a much bigger internal volume to keep safe from the pressure of the depths. So that means that in general American boats weren't able to dive as deep as German U-boats, which is obviously a big consideration. And finally, the biggest thing for me, and the reason why I wish this was a German U-boat, is down here. That's a single rudder, and the Germans have twin rudders. And believe me, that makes a huge difference, because your boat is not only bigger, so it's going to be more resistant to course changes, but also has smaller control areas. So that means that your rudder isn't far from as effective as in a German U-boat. So these things are much roomier, much larger, have more torpedoes, they hit harder, and yeah, all that stuff, which is really great. But at the time of maneuvering, these things are not that good. So yeah, little nifty bag of tricks, and yeah, after this campaign and this let's play, if well, people like it, I will do a Silent Hunter 3 or even a Silent Hunter 4-1 with German U-boats, so you will be able to see the differences, well, just by seeing the let's play. In the meantime, well, we have a war to fight, and we have a course to plot, so let's do that. No, I don't want all stop. I didn't have any orders, and I ordered them to follow the plot course, and I have none. So I'm going to plot this course. We are going to do kind of a landfall here, to do a land check to know we are where we should be, and then we are going to head towards Valley. We are going to try to cross this strait, and hoping here that there's no destroyers guarding it. Then we are going to actually go past here and start moving through the Java Sea, hoping we find no droids. Stupid and easy comment about Star Wars. And finally, we will arrive at our billet area. As you can see, I'm generally putting my courses in light blue areas, and that's because the deep blue ones are shallow waters, and you don't want to be on shallow waters because, yeah, there you can't dive very deep, and submarines survive by going very deep if they are detected. So, well, we are all set up, we are all in our merry way. We are going to do a shitload of miles here. It's 2600 miles. Yeah, I think this one doesn't have as much range as I thought. Well, this is a Sargo class, not a Gato, but even then. Well, we'll be there in roughly 10 days, so we better start get going. Obviously, the first leg of the trip is going to be very uneventful, so, well, let's go. Well, one of the things I want to try before I go into an operational area is whether we can use Dexawars.
24. Yes, sir.
24 feet, that will get us lower on the water. I'm not totally sure, and I don't know whether this mod allows for Dexawars. And I'd really love to be able to do that. Seems 25 feet doesn't make any difference. Let's see.
Yes, sir. New depth, 2, 8. Yes, sir.
28 knot, 28 feet.
Dive.
Well, it's giving us the order to dive, which is not really great. But let me see. We are obviously going deeper. This would be really great for shallow approaches by night, or when we don't want to give our position away. Seems to be working fine so far. Of course, we pay at all in speed because the resistance of the water is much bigger, but our profile is much smaller. Of course, this we wouldn't use in very rough weather, because the waves would come off the top of our bridge. But yeah, seems that ordering 28 puts us in Dexawars, which is obviously really good to know. Okay.
Yes, sir. Surface the boat.
Yes, let's sir. Go back to our
surface,
normal.
Surface.
Depth of surface running and keep on moving towards our intended billet area. So yeah, I'll catch up when something happens. Okay, a couple days have passed by, nothing to report, lookouts in their assigned areas, and yeah. We are alongside the Northwest Cape. We are leaving Australia. Now the final leg before entering a battle zone. So yep, just, well, to keep you guys updated of how things are going. Let's move on. Okay, weather is getting worse, some very heavy waves. It's dark night here. By the way, now I think of it, YouTube shits on dark video, so I'm going to increase the brightness of the night parts of my Let's Play in the edition software, because otherwise you won't be able to see crap. And you aren't going to see a lot by night anyway, because really visibility with the mods is really, really bad during night. At any rate, we have received a flash traffic message. Let's see what it says. Patrol in the Bismarck Sea, Peleliu to Wewak, blah blah blah. No, we are not in the Bismarck Sea. Now, in case you are wondering, we are in the Indian Ocean, moving from Australia to the Borneo Singapore area. The Bismarck Sea, it's here. And that's a long way to go. Also, that's the operational area of the submarines operating from Brisbane and Sydney, so yeah. Not our business, so let's keep on going, and when something happens again, I will keep you updated. Okay, weather is not getting any better at all. Any better at all. Dark pitch night. Holy crap, those are lots of waves. And we have received yet another message. Two forces afloat, Luzon Straits, blah, 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 July the 10th. It's 2 days from here, let me check on that. We are about to cross the Bali Straits, which is really great. We are going to do this by night. By day we will be out of them, so that's really good. Luzon Straits. Yeah. I'm thinking we are a little bit out of position to attend to that as well, so let's keep on going our merry way and cross this channel. I hope there's no escorts or warships patrolling this zone. If there's some, you will know, because I will stop the... I will stop to tell you. Let's move on. Well, land is there. You can barely see it, but it's there. There's a mountain there. We are exiting the straits, and there's been no enemy activity. Have made sure I have dived to do a contact check. I also have the radar going on, so no contacts. Which is all good for me, because I don't like warships. I like warships, but not when I'm in a sub. Especially if they are enemy. The weather is getting a little bit better, however, not by much, but yeah, 14 meters per second, well, it's a little bit less than what it was some hours ago. So we are almost out, so it's a relief. Let's keep on going in this last leg of our course towards our patrol area. Well, weather is getting a little bit better. Again, it's by night. We are in the night of July the 9th. The 9th or 9th, yeah. We have yet another message. Let's check it out. Again, near Peleliu, near the Bismarck Sea. No, that's not for us. Okay. Since all intelligence is about places we are not right now. But, well, we'll keep on going. We are in the middle of the Java Sea, and soon we will reach Karimara Strait and reach our destination in roughly 2 days. So, yep, moving on. Well, we are in our billet area. So now we have entered our patrol zone. Singapore is here. I'm guessing shipping routes will go through this area. So I'm going to lay a course towards that zone and do several zigzags. Have to be here for 4 days. So yeah, we are going to go at standard speed there and do our patrol at 1/3. That will save some fuel, I guess. We have spent roughly 40% of our fuel just to reach here, so we have to keep that in mind. So, weather's looking quite better. Still some waves, but not the very bad seas we were having. So, also visibility is pretty good. We have our radar, so everything's good. Boy, you are ugly. Okay. Let's move on. Well, it's July the 11th. Splendid seas. Calm weather. And absolutely nothing to report. This is not the most interesting patrol area I've ever been at. But, well, just to keep you guys updated on what's going on. We are at 1/3. Moving in our zigzag pattern, trying to find something which is coming this way. If nothing is there, we will come back and do a zigzag here. We have 4 days. Well, no, 3. So, yeah. Let's hope we find something. We'll see. Well, as we are moving along and keeping our patrol area covered and finding absolutely nothing, we have even more messages. Near the Formosa Straits. Oh, again. Ooh, from homewards to Singapore. Southern of the Formosa, AM 15 July. 2 days from now. To Singapore, right? Problem is the Formosa Straits are this. Let me check. From here to here, that's how much? Holy shit. 1700 miles. At 10 knots, that will be 170 hours. 170 hours is roughly 1 week. So in 1 week or so, they will be here. That's a lot of time to wait, and yeah, our fuel is not that great. So I guess we can forget about that as well. We are obviously not going to move there, because it's way, way, way off our position. Sad face, really. We are not getting lucky. Hopefully we will find something. Really, I need to find something. Not that I need, but I'd really like to. Yep. Well, let's keep on moving. Ooh. Target around 20-19 degrees of our bow. I was doing one of my regular dives. And yeah, 19 degrees to the bow, right? Let's plot that. Let's stop for a second because we don't want the sub moving while we do this. Around 2019, yeah, more or less there. Now let's do another line and move it beyond. First contact report there. So it's either from Singapore or into Singapore. We will have to find out. So what I'm going to do is to order 240 degrees.
Sir, new course.
Let some time pass. Okay, should be down here, is there. Degrees.
Contact, merchant, moving away, bearing.
It's moving away, 61.
Long range.
Okay, let me check that. Here and from here, let's make this a lot longer. There. Okay, one was here. I'm guessing it's something with a northerly course, because it's moving away, not closer. So surface the boat.
Surface the boat.
Flag speed ahead.
Surface. New surface. Course. Surface. Five.
And let's try to find whatever it is. It's a very calm weather. Very calm seas as well. And up we are going. Good. That sounded like a mercant of some kind. So yeah, let's move. Actually, I'm going to move at 330 degrees. What I'm puzzled about is that we don't have any. Oh, ho, 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 ho. Okay, we have a radar reading. We do have a radar reading. Let me check this. There, 14,000 yards. I just saw it. On this bearing, where? There. It's a very big spike as well. Around 14,000 yards at a bearing of 10 degrees. 330, little less than 330. Okay, let me plot this. Ooh, look, we have it. Okay. Now we have your position. Here. Come on, center it well. Roughly there. Okay. If I assume it's moving north and I'm heading like so, we are closing in quite rapidly. I'm going to order an orderly course. New course. 3, 5. Yes, sir. To run parallel to it, overtake it, and then come in. Let's advance a little bit. Roughly 10 minutes. 9, 10. Okay. Go back. Should be in our port side. It's there. Around 280 something. We have a reading. Yeah, around 1300 yards. Yes, it's moving north. Okay, let's plot this. Ooh, it's moving on a northwest course.
New course, 3, 3. Yes, sir.
Roger. Let's plot a more or less estimation of his course, which roughly seems to be 330 something, around 330. And now we can get rid of all this junk, which we don't need for anything. Yeah, okay, this is going to require a pretty long chase. I'm going to reduce to full. I'm burning a lot of fuel here and I really don't have fuel to spare, so let's move forward. Also, we are very close to daytime, which is unfortunate, but not much we can do.
Ship spotted.
Okay.
Bearing 270, long range.
Perfectly on course. We have her course perfectly narrowed down. Good. So, again, we have the range through the radar, so this is no dark magic. We should see her, right? 270. Well, maybe we should see her, but I don't see crap. But yeah, if radar says it's there, then it's there. Call for battle stations. So, see, he's in a course of 330, we are in a course of 330, we are running mostly parallel of him. We will get ahead and then set for an attack. In the meantime, what I'm going to do is another thing. I'm going to bring the chronometer up. I'm going to stop. Drop a mark where he is. Exactly there. And start the clock. Going to let it run for 3 minutes. 1 minute. 2 minutes. 3 minutes. Let's mark this down. His position, roughly. Okay. Now we can get rid of this and So we have a range thanks to our radar. We have two marks, 3 minutes apart. And the 3 minute rule says that the time you take to travel a number of hundreds of yards in 3 minutes is equal to your speed in knots. So 800 yards, that means 8 knots. I have a nomograph here. Here you can see the perfect rule of that. As long as you pick your starting point at 3 minutes, whatever you cross, throw out lines perfectly with the projected speed. As you can see, here is the speed in knot, here is the distance the contact has moved in yards, and here is the time in minutes. When you are measuring in metric, in meters, I mean, it's 3 minutes and one quarter or so, I think. But yeah, we have the speed, it's 8 knots, and we are moving at 18, that's too much. We don't need that much speed. Okay, so we are going to set for an interception course. We know that it's 3 minutes, well, whatever, we don't really need. We know the course, we know the heading of this dude, and I'm going to give it 10 more minutes. 10 more minutes, there we go. And what's the distance of the track? Okay, let's start moving west northwest.
Yes, sir.
Increase the speed.
New course, 3-0.
Yes, sir.
One. Ahead full.
Roger. So if he's moving at 8 knots,
yes,
now if we go at...
Yes, sir.
Yep, radar, he's here, good. Now if he's moving at 8 knots, and I go to 7 knots, which is 1/3 roughly, and we go in a course which is roughly... Hold on a second, yeah, this is the protractor. Which course do I need? Let's take a look at that. 90 degrees means I need a course of 250. Let's dial that in. I don't even know what it is yet.
New course, two,
four, yes, sir. And supposedly we can see here, so let's make sure. Where is he? There he is. Seems a merchant of some type, obviously. Let me bring this up. Where were you? I've lost track. There, look. Let me check this. Mercant, some kind of speed freighter, I think. Composite freighter. There. No. No. Could be, but no. Definitely no. Not at all. Absolutely not. Your stack doesn't look like this. You might be it. Modern Spirit Freighter. 3,262 tons. Yeah. Yeah, might be it. Not sure. For now I'm going to go for this, but let's check more. No, no, you're not this. You could be this. Yeah, you could. No, I don't think you are this. Your masts don't look like this. No. Too little distance between the superstructure and the funnel. No. No. Okay. Yeah, I think we got him right. It's a medium modern spilt freighter. Just in case, we will keep that.
Ship spotted.
Yeah, I know, I know. We've seen that dude. Medium model composite fighter. Might be this. Which is the difference? Well, the base height is the same. Draft is very similar. Now, if it's this, that might be a problem. And might very well be. We need to be closer to be sure. At any rate, we are at a distance of 6,000 yards, that's too much. We need increase this speed.
Ahead, flank.
Going to go for 5 minutes. 10. Come on. There. And now I'm going to dive.
Periscope depth.
Ahead 1/3.
Dive.
And we will complete our recognition underwater while we slow down. Because at this speed, we will come close to the track and be able to shoot torpedoes in at a very pretty decent range. Okay. First, I'm going to start putting torpedo information here. 15. Yeah, seems okay. 15 and fast. 15 and fast. 15. Okay, so you are fast on 15, fast on 15, fast on 15. I'm going to launch probably a couple torpedoes. Okay, we are already underwater. There's this. And now we can make a more accurate assessment of what it is. No, modern spilt freighter, it's not for sure, that I can tell. The masts doesn't look like that. No, that's not it. Looks more like this. Could be this? Well, these are very prominent, and these are as well here, so no, I think this is it. Okay, let's reduce this up here. So we know he's roughly 45 degrees of our, well, of angle on bow. That is moving at 8 knots. And the range I'm going to find in a second. Draft 24, yeah, that works for me. Actually, this is a good moment to do a decocaine attack, but I'm going to try to do it manual. I need practice in this. Position keeper. There we go. 770. Is this accurate? Let's see in our chart. I'm going to measure it not using this, but this 3000. See, yeah, it's on our predicted line more or less. I'm not using the contacts to measure distances. If I have an error, I have an error. Okay, so we can do those two things here. One is do a decocaine, which is we are in a perfect situation to do so. It's going to be at how many yards away? 2,300 yards. That's okay. Actually, we could be a little bit closer, but who cares? Let's hit this dude. Okay. Follow this. 110.
3-1-0.
How does this hold? Yeah, 3-1-1. It's more or less on the bearing we were expecting it to be. The position meter keeps everything updated. By the way, we have a course. We know she's at in a course of 340.
Bearing
3-1-1. 340. So yeah, we had a pretty good estimation of the angle on bow, actually. We need to make this coincide with the course we know she's heading to. That's too much. There. I'll just make sure that you are tracking this properly. Okay, let's do another range. Ooh, you look so tasty.
3-1-2.
Ranging. There. Yeah. The estimated target course and speed is pretty much on target. Okay. So what I'm going to do is to Sera de cocaine, I'm guessing. Well, don't know. It's in 343, right?
Bearing 313.
Yeah. 313. When she's at 340, she will have an angle on bow of 60. That's why this is the reason why I like the German system a little bit better. It allows for much more precise things with the system engaged. If you're wondering what's happening here, is that I want to shoot as he passes my marks, so I can aim torpedoes instead of lobbing them with a somewhat offset of degrees, which is the best you can do when you have the position keeper up. So I'm going to bring the position keeper down. When he's at 340, he will be 20 degrees from being in front of us. When he's in front of us, he's going to be at 90 degrees. So when he's at 340, he's going to be at 70 degrees, right? The speed we have, so that's no problem. And the distance we will read before launching torpedoes. We don't really need it, because with this method of attacking, usually you don't need any range measurement. Errors cancel out on themselves on these kind of shots. This is a perfect attack situation, by the way. So once the target crosses this line, the place we throw the torpedoes is the place they will hit. Okay. You are moving merrily. Let's put our periscope there. Perfectly on target, good. And now we will use the observation one to keep looking. The observation one allows for better lighting. You can see better the features. I'm going to make sure this is what I expected it to be. Yes, yes. 2-2-2-2. Here. And the superstructure in the back is that. Yep. We have a correct ID. Let's drop the observation scope. Wanted to make sure we have everything set up. Good. So you can see, yes, the position keeper is off. We don't have an update of the movement of the enemy. We don't need it. We don't really need it. Let's go back to the attack scope. C320. He's there. 20 degrees of our mark. Going to open tube 2 and tube 1. Going to make sure we have no offset. Good. Another way to do this is keeping the position keeper on and shooting with a little offset to be sure that you are not hitting on the same place. It's really good if you are using the position keeper, but for this attack I have a perfect... This is called the decocaine method, by the way. Was done and made famous by a US captain during World War II. Captain of USS Stan, I think it was. I'm speaking of memory. Maybe he was of other ship, but... Yeah, he's there. We will do a last range reading at 335, and then we will update the solution for 340. Let me check how it's looking. We should be at a range of around 2,000 yards. Less. Okay, this circle is lesser than what I thought. I thought it was 1,500 yards, but it's only one click. Well, that's good. That's really close. I'm liking that. Yeah, it's a matter of waiting. I could increase the time compression, but honestly, I usually don't like to do that during attacks. Okay. Let's do a last... He's at 330. Once he's here, we do... a last range reading. Let me check on that. We need him locked. Good. Should be there. Good. We have that range. We lock the periscope there. We send it there. And okay. I'm going to put one torpedo here and one torpedo here. Actually, a little bit in front. This should be flawless. I should get perfect hits here. Unless we get dudes, of course. So always can happen. Let's lower this. We don't want to give away anything before we load the torpedoes. Okay, it's crossing the mark. Reaching the point of... So tube 1. Sub 2-2. Torpedo in the water. Bearing 3-4-0. Drop the periscope. Okay, this should be a pretty quick impact if we get it. Predicted impact is at 3-4-7. Which is there. We should be getting impact as the target crosses this line. Okay.
Torpedo impact.
Perfect. The second one.
Torpedo impact.
Perfect impact. Two good hits. This should kill her. We are going to remain on the lookout, however, in case we need to finish her off with a deck gun. But I don't like deck gun actions. Let me check. Yeah, he has a gun up there. Those things are nasty. But two hits. One in the engines I mean, that's the engine area. He's still putting smoke, means the engines are not out. There's a slight propeller plume here, which means he's still turning the props. Let me hear what this. We can barely hear her. So whatever she's doing with the propeller, she's at a very, very, very slow speed. I think she's doomed. Well, only can only hope, of course. Are you feeling okay? No, you don't. She has stopped. Yep. She's stopped on the water. Okay, let's reduce speed to 1 knot. I'm not going to stop because submarines couldn't stop and keep the depth. That's something I've seen a lot of YouTubers doing, and honestly, that's not historical. If we need a further torpedo, we will do. We will send it. Okay, guys, I'm going to keep this and wait until she goes down or she needs another torpedo. I'm not going to use the deck gun because, honestly, the time I tried it against the Mercant, which was as damaged as this, it was utter disaster. I went down. So, the gun's not an option. Again, at least not if the enemy has a gun. So we'll wait it out and I'll keep you updated. Okay, this is how she looks so far. We can check the damage we did, which is a big, big, massive amount of damage. Propeller has completely stopped. She's stopped on the water. And I guess progressive flooding will do her. And if it doesn't, well, we'll finish her off. It's being close to dawn, however. So we can't remain here for a very long time, because obviously this guy will have called for help. And we might have some enemy friends, yeah, pun intended, coming close very soon. So yeah, I'll keep you updated on what's going on. Well, little update is she's not longer making any kind of plume of smoke. She's laying very low by the rear part, and yes, she's looking really, really, really hurting. Fire is going on. See, we have lost the sound contact with her, so that means no propeller sounds, no machinery sounds. This thing is doomed. Oh, she's making smoke again. Damn it. She's restarted the engine, but doesn't seem there's any propeller sounds. Let me check on that. Absolutely nothing. Nope. 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 Yes, he's going. Look at that. Definitely going down. And that was 4,000 tons. Well, not the biggest target ever. But hey, who am I to complain? At least we found something to sink. You can see here us looking, well, moving very slow, but moving. Because if you don't move in a submarine like this, this is World War II, let's remember, neutral flotation was almost impossible to completely achieve through the use of ballast tanks. So the dive planes were used to keep the submarine at the desired depth. Really important to keep some motion, otherwise the submarine will generally go up, or if the trim was badly done, might even go under. Which is preferable to go under than to breach the surface in front of an enemy destroyer, right? How is this looking? Yes, it's sinking. Okay, again. Waiting for the time to do more updates on her state. Well, she definitely is sinking slowly, but very slowly. I really thought by now she would be going down, but since that she has somehow stabilized somewhat. She's still sinking lower. I'm looking at that crane as a reference point, and yeah, the water is rising. So what I'm doing here is turning slightly. I'm going to pass through here, and if she doesn't go down on her own, I will use an aft torpedo to finish her off. But honestly, I don't think we'll need to do that. At least here's hoping we don't. Yeah, as you can see, the crane is slowly dipping underwater. This is a point where usually I would surface and finish this guy off with the gun, but honestly, that thing scares the shit out of me. And I don't want to be sunk by a sinking enemy transport, honestly. Maybe when we are directly behind her, so I'm going to keep on turning for a while. I'm going to order.
Yes, sir.
Ahead 1/3. We were moving at roughly 1 knot. That will put us at 3 knots. That will give us a little bit more leverage on the rudder to go clear of her rear. Maybe when we go alongside her, we stop there and put some rounds on her upside to convince her to go down. But that will be when we are out of the arcs of fire of that thing there. Meanwhile, I'm not... Ooh, now she's going down much faster. Okay. Stop turning. Yeah, now the rate of flooding has must have increased or something, because now she's going down much faster. No need to do the gun with this. This is a sunk ship. Yep. Not going to order surface until that thing is sinking, because otherwise, really, I don't want to be shot by that. I might seem paranoid, but honestly, in the test run I did, the results were catastrophic. And now it seems really, really, really sinking much faster. Took a while. For a time, seems she was stabilizing, but no, she's not. This thing is going down. And there we have it. The final notification. She's going down. Enemy ship sinking. Okay. Yes. Surface the boat.
Surface the boat.
Call off battle stations.
Surface. Secure surface. From battle stations.
Resume our patrol course. And now we can put down our periscope. And move to the deck. Yep, definitely going down. Well, that's a success. That's one less ship the Japanese have to carry goods. Down she goes. Down she goes. Well, that was a pretty effective attack, if I might say so myself. Radar is a really nice thing to have, because it allows you, as you see, to make a very early on course estimation, which allows you to deploy a perfectly line up 90 degree attack, and those are deadly. Those are really, really, really deadly. Okay, let's delete that crap. And yeah, those two, that's dedication, man. Well, I guess that's the Japanese thing of dying for the Emperor. I don't know. I would be in a lifeboat, honestly. By these states. Yeah, we can hear the hull cracking. You can see the water rising. And that ship should be no more in a few seconds. As we harmlessly pass by. Yep, now she's barely... Now finally they left the goddamn gun. There's no life raft, however, not that I can see. But yeah, It's only the mass remaining. Obviously, it's time I sink a ship. I won't sew the whole process, but I think it's cool for one time to sew it. There it goes. And with that, we got our first confirmed kill. Well, I think this is a good place to put a stop to our first video. I hope you enjoyed it, guys. Very easy attack on that one. A little bit boring of a trip from Fremantle to a patrol area, but thankfully we found something, and that something will give us at least some good renown, I guess, and prestige and things, so we can spend at port to improve our sub. At any rate, for now, it's going to be it. Thank you very much, guys, for watching, and see you later.